the year, the sixth year of Ivalantho, last year, 38 babies were born, and we initiated 21 children as adults. The clan has 21 fewer people, 8 fewer head of cattle, and 18 fewer horses than we did last sacred time. Now, this number is slightly wrong because some of our horses have gone with expeditions, so that might not be accurate. Our crafters produced 68 cows worth of goods. Our market made a profit of 30 cows worth of goods. Maintaining our shrines and temples took 25 cows and goods worth 50 cows. We have no goods left. Oh dear. Our priests felt that our standing among the other clans would rise, no matter what foolish things we did. We're known for adopting outsiders. Right. There we go. We definitely need all that, because our food situation is dreadful. Probably worth putting a point into ritual, and I think a point in diplomacy will help as well. Yeah, we'll go with that. Could not afford to make the proper sacrifices to Elmol, and our temple is now effectively just a shrine. Currently maintaining our shrines, 25 cows, 50 cows worth of goods, okay. Members of the Blazing Runners have taken to escaping from their fear and hunger by smoking the dried stamens of a mysterious flower. This greatly concerns their circle, as the smoke renders people listless and unwary. Yet every time they cut down a stand of these plants, another one springs up. If only good grass or honest wheat grew as avidly in these hungry times. Oh dear. Our caravan is back from the Arrowstones. The Arrowstone traders were pleased to receive the first caravan we'd sent to them in recent memory. They said that access to more horses was always a good thing and agreed to trade with us on a regular basis. We made a small profit from the trip. Excellent. And our emissary, an Eldester, nears the Blazing Run settlement. She brought 10 cows in goods to present as a gift. Let's just give the gifts. The Blazing Runners more than once praise the gifts presented to them. I believe they're more favourably disposed towards us now, though with foreigners it can be hard to tell. Fine. Whatever. And it looks like the clan mood's getting worse by the day. We've got one season of food in our stores, which is not a good sign. But we have a seasonal market now, which is good. Now, with the Elmol Shrine falling down to a temple status. Elmol Temple falling to a shrine status seems to have freed up space for another shrine, but our goods situation is not so good. So I think we should probably hold off for now. Let's see what spirits we can... Let's see if we can cajole the earthworm spirit to helping us. Because we definitely need to eke out every little food advantage we can get. Dresta made an arrangement with the earthworm spirit to help the clan for several years. Worms wriggled their way to the fields, burrowing down among the furrows. Hopefully that works. Oh dear, this doesn't look so good. A terrifying being with a bulging head fearsome tentacles and man-like shape somehow made its way into the citadel. It snatched a child, then skittered out of sight. The lore speaker says this is a type of chaos creature called a walktapus. Oh no. Oh dear. It's a walktapus. Do we scour the citadel for the creature? Do we send a party to hunt the creature outside the hill fort? Do we call on Uruks to ward the citadel against chaos? Or do we say the creature is long gone by now? If you cut a walktapus in two, an hour later you'll have two walktapi. The creature will be hard to find and formidable if caught. For an outside hunt, take more than four but fewer than nine warriors. Okay. All we can do is endure. A walktapus can use its tentacles to fight four enemies at once, or squirt a cloud of poisonous gas. Oh dear. Uruks might ward the citadel, but how often does chaos attack it? Well, I think once is more than enough. Walktapi regenerate their wounds, right? Yeah, I don't think sending a party to hunt the creature is going to help. If these things can regenerate and even split into two, if such a thing happens, then, well, either we arm the hunters with fire, which we're not explicitly stating we're doing anywhere here. I think we need to call on Uruks again. And we're going to have to go with nine goods on this. At least make sure it's not in sight. Yeah. The mark of the winged bull appeared on our citadel wall. Priests said this would bolster us whenever chaos tried to come inside. Okay, there we go. Got one season's worth of food again, so hopefully this is going to be good. Yeah. As much as I want to send out expeditions to improve our relations with the locals, I don't think we have the goods for it now. We need to knuckle down a bit, so we've got 10 swords. Well, we've got 14 swords, 15 if we include the sick. We should probably try and get some more. I'm okay with recruiting from outside the clan now, but we won't give the additional goods. Hey, Akoneko! Good to see you. How's it going? We're in the second year, well, I guess third year of the demo now, so we're in the final year of this Six Ages 2 demo. And yeah, it's really proving to be quite a challenge. Back at work, mostly over being sick, bit of lingering congestion. Oh dear. Well, I mean, at least you're mostly over it. I find that once you start getting over it, you start to sort of feel better generally, and sometimes I feel better after being sick than when I was before. Maybe it's just me being grateful I'm no longer sick, though. Anyway, we'll see if we can get the extra swords. We're only able to raise two more, but that's still better than nothing. My game blessing continues to bolster our hunting yield. We see no indication that our neighbours have discovered our use of it. Good. Right. Helmer has gained support among the clan elders to dismantle your temples to dead gods. We'll still sacrifice Langomai, Analda, Isaris, and Orlanth, but we will get nothing in return because they are dead. It's time to face facts and save our wealth for the living, gods and people both. Jarlanth leads the opposition to this idea. When the sleeping gods wake, they will remember which clans honoured them when they needed it the most. Tearing down their holy places would be an act of gross impiety. Currently, the clan maintains temples to Langomai, Analda, Isaris, and Orlanth. Do we denounce this sacrilegious suggestion? Do we tactfully refuse? Do we reduce the size of the temples to the size of a temple to a dead god? Do we dismantle a temple to a dead god? Dismantle all the temples to dead gods? What's the name of the gambit related to the to future punishment? Name of the gambit that related to future punishment. I don't think I know that one. I know what you mean, though. Thing is, if you know your lore, the world is bound to be remade, and well, we've been playing King of Dragon Pass, and Orlanth, Analda, Isaris, and Langomai are all well and serving us as we serve them, so. Pascal's Wager. That was it. Yes. The thing with Pascal's Wager is that there is no tangible, or arguably no tangible evidence. So, but yeah, I think you're, you make a good point there. In the real world, this is a much different, discussion to have, but in the world of Glorantha, we actually have gods making themselves known in person, and some of these gods have disappeared. It's very unusual for this to happen. Do we hold out hope just as the just as we selected with the strand at the beginning of the game? Or do we forgo hope and think more pragmatically? The thing is, we are tying up a lot of resources in those shrines, but I still feel those temples are necessary. Probably won't be that necessary in this demo, but I'm trying to play this as if this were the full game. If only because it's good training for when I inevitably do buy the full game. But yeah, I think it might be worth reducing the size of a temple just so that we can get another shrine up and running. because we don't have the population to have the temples and more shrines. I think we can reduce the size of one temple, see how it goes. I really don't like the idea of the residual spark of magic going out. So if we see that go out on whichever temple, then we know for future reference that that's what happens if a temple is reduced to a shrine. It's almost certain that the spark will go out if the temple is dismantled entirely. But yeah, I think we'll reduce the size of a temple to a dead god. And I think Lankomai is probably going to be the one taking the hit here. As much as I like Lankomai, his blessings aren't that great, especially right now. Well, I mean, especially right now, seeing as they don't work. But I found in Six Ages and King of Dragon Pass, his blessings are kind of... Hey, Voig, how's it going? Yeah, the music. I really love the music in these games. They're a breath of fresh air, if you ask me. Something quite different to what a lot of other games do. But yeah, I think we'll reduce this temple to a shrine. Sorry, Lankomai. I do like you, but your blessings are kind of secondary compared to Orlanth and Anulda and Asiris, Isaris. The people thought this was a good compromise between respecting Lankomai's memory and a concern for the clan. Right. Okay. So we got 17 swords now in all. We'll see how that goes. And less than a season. But early fire season. That's not a good sign. Okay. We've got the Earthworm Spirit doing his thing. But we have room for a shrine now. So let's build a shrine to Dostal. We'll get that sure shot blessing going. Our food situation is desperate. We could ask for Yerolda's milk blessing to stave off future trouble. We can also go outside the clan and trade for or request food. But right now we face the possibility of starvation. We have less than a season's worth of food stockpiled. Maybe we can hold out until the harvest in about 8 weeks. We should be able to. But we can go on a venture to improve things further, and we have just created a shrine to Dostal. Starvation, yeah! People hope that the clan was right and we'd be able to bring in the food. Oh, here we go. A delegation from the Delascarin clan arrives to make an intriguing offer. These Orlanthi never joined the Baroneth Telly tribe, and thus never learned to ride horses. They worship a bear god instead of Dostal the Hunter, and also venerate their namesake hero, Delascar. They grow foods no one else can, mostly a root vegetable called a turnip. They want to trade a bowl of miraculous berries from the sacred bush of their founder for one of your treasures, the bowl of healing smoke. Though this is a dear price, eating these arrow berries will greatly revive the flagging glorious herd morale. Austerina says the bowl of healing smoke might be worth around 44 cows. It aids in curing the sick. No, we need these treasures, so we're going to have to decline. Yeah, gonna decline. They said they understood the bowl of healing smoke was a valuable treasure. Yeah. Especially as we have been struggling a bit with the sick, although the number of sick is going down now that we've been able to invest some magic into healing the sick. Mood is still dissatisfied though, which is less than ideal. But it is now late fire season, so I'm going to have to pull a rabbit out of the hat with this one now. What ventures can we go on? We've got no venture in progress, so we could go for one now. The crafting venture would be pretty good. We don't have the foraging venture going, so that's also a potential venture to go on. Yeah, I think we'll go with the foraging. And Jolanth, once again, you're going to be the one for this. Jolanth and our foragers discovered that even the bitter apples were too full of worms. They brought back what they could. That's not so good. Still, might be something. Redda, a member of your clan, celebrated for her connection to her ancestor, the horse goddess Redalda, petitions the ring to undertake a quest. A divine vision tells her that by slipping through a hole in the world, she can ride Karandar, the legendary mount of your first king. She wishes to take... I'm going to say Karandar, because Charandar... sounds a little too close to Charmander. She wishes to take a small escort of stout warriors with her on this admittedly dangerous mission. I now step out of the chamber, so the rest of you may discuss this frankly. So do we grant permission, withhold permission, or caution people against trusting in Redder's wild schemes? When an individual is more popular than the ring as a whole, the rest look weak. Karandar was killed by chaos creatures. Is that true, Hanth? A journey to the past will only remind us of our lamentable present. She will die, leading chaos to our gate. Holes in the world grow more numerous every year. Never be sure what's on the other side, or if you can get back again. An encounter with Karandar will lead to the gift of a magic horse, or the sorts of lesser blessings you get from a temple. Dresta seems a little more optimistic than the rest of the ring. Our holes are numerous. Oh, behave. Yeah, this is, It's the difficult one, because this has a promise of a potential treasure in the form of a magic horse. Mm-hmm. I think we might try and give it a go. It does mean the possibility of losing Redolda, a renowned diplomat. Sorry, Redder, a renowned diplomat. Yeah, let's give it a go. See what happens. How many warriors accompany Redder? There we go. 14. Redder said that it could be a season or more before she returned. Okay. It's an Earth season. We have less than a season's worth of food in our stockpile, but it is Earth season, so we're bringing food in from the fields. That's going to help. Right, now. Maybe it will be worth us once again going on an exploration mission in within our territory. We might be able to find something. Let's send Jastar on this one. A little bit of training won't go amiss for Jastar, rather. And who knows? We might be able to find something here. We'll reduce the number of bows. We don't need to go crazy within our own territory. We spent some time poking around our wildlands. We didn't find anything strange or unusual, but we did find 8 cows worth of ivory fragments. Well, that's something. And it looks like we've got something else going on. While hunting, your docile devotee Hunth is bitten by a centipede spirit. Its spectral poison will soon take hold of him, debilitating him for some time to come. Your shaman Destra refuses to help. He asked rudely, she says, and when I spoke to the centipede, it said that Hanth had broken a taboo and then insulted it as well. The spirit says that if we counteract the poison, it will curse us all. If you ask me, the bumptious Hanth has deserved something like this for a long time. Hmm. I said nothing to that centipede. It didn't... My head spinning. Ugh. Anyway, do we let Hanth take his lumps? Do we admonish Dresta for her refusal? Do we instruct Destel to offer the Spirit Clan magic to reverse the poison? Or do we call on Chelana or Roy to heal Hanth? At least no one cares what Destra or Hanth think about the crown. What? That really doesn't help this situation. When I hear centipede curse, I worry for our foraging. I worry about our foraging. An angry spirit might ask for considerable magic. The poison won't fell Hanth for long. I won't repeat the terrible things Hanth said to the centipede. Well, I think he takes his lumps, to be honest. We don't have much in the way of magic. I don't think we're going to be able to have a magic way out of this. And I don't like the idea of angering the spirits when our gods are abandoning us. Whether it's their fault or not. And yeah, we'll let Hanth take his lumps. He fell into a deep and fretful slumber Our healing magic could not wake him. People decried the council's indifference. How would we eat without game caught by the mighty Hanth? Yes, well, there is a way around that. Heron, we've once again come asking for donations of fish. Drestor easily persuaded the Heron Spirit to help the clan. The Heron Spirit showed off his fishermen where to go, and they brought in food for the clan. Most of it was eels, but there were also a number of frogs. We seem to be including frogs into our diet fairly frequently now. But it is now dark season. Hopefully we'll be able to get something going, and we can get a venture going. I think now would be a good time for us to trap for furs. And, we'll put Venestra to this task. Training an Ermal worshipper, what could go wrong? Venestra said the animals had the most valuable furs in dark season, but it was also hard to go out in the snow to check the traps. She and the hunters kept trying, but the gods of winter were no friends of ours. Ah, that didn't go so well then. The shape-stealer ghosts ambushed our regalia hunting expedition. Karenna's explorers defended themselves and won, but three of them came back injured. Karenna thought a return mission might have more luck. Okay. Karenna, a fearsome warrior of your clan, says she intends to hunt and slay Polynom, a chieftain of a nearby Zarhawk clan. In a vision, her god Humor, Death Dealer, accused Polynom of speaking to the dead. Not in the ordinary way one contacts the spirits of one's ancestors, but by digging up funeral dolls to gain the secrets of talking skulls. Karenna does not seek permission. She is simply telling you where she's headed for the next few days. Oh. So, do we wish her well? Do we send an escort? Do we say, make it clear you kill for Humakt and not on our behalf? Do we dissuade her, or do we forbid this? The trickster found what he thought was a stick, and it was really death. Humakt took it, so someone trustworthy would have it. Let Karenna do this alone. An escort will only get in her way. This had better not end up with us owing a rare guild for chief. She'll carve her way through the Zarhawks right quick. Completing this mission will enhance her already formidable fighting prowess. Okay. Yeah, I think we wish her well. It seems like the clan is no friend of the Zarhawks, so we'll wish her well. The people who feared Karenna more than they liked her worried that no good would come of this. Karenna returned to say she had succeeded, cleaving her way through Polynom's guard and sending him forever to the lightless underworld. As she did so, Humakt blessed her with additional speed and strength, which was now hers to keep. Well, there we go. We now have a clan that hates us, but that's fine. What's not fine is walking skeletons attacking our foragers out in the wildlands beyond Berenstead's walls. Several of them were wounded before a patrol heard their cries and rode to the rescue. Though not the most dangerous opponents you've ever faced, they did prove frustratingly tenacious. They kept crawling at your defenders until every part of them was bashed apart. You're not wrong there, Neko. Inside each of us is a skeleton waiting to come out. Yeah. Do we call on Humact, god of death, for a blessing against the undead? Do we call on Urux, the Stormbowl, for a blessing against chaos? Do we send out warriors to look for other walking skeletons? Or we mustn't overreact to every minor threat. Good time to call for bravery. Walking skeletons aren't new, but their growth in numbers is. One of them stabbed Alessandra with a dagger made from one of its own ribs. Oh dear. The undead are one particular type of chaos monster. Humac blessing would be more powerful against undead than Uroxes, which, however, could aid us against all chaos enemies. Well, we've been blessing, sacrificing to Urox fairly frequently recently, so maybe a Humac blessing will be in order this time. Yeah, I think a blessing to, from Humact is in need here. So we'll go with that and do the usual nine goods. Our death cultists meditated upon their honour, informing the god that they were plagued by beings who trespassed the border separating life from death. He filled their swords with a ward against them. At least it's not another walktapus, yeah. You're not wrong then, Nemaxis. Okay. It is now late dark season. So we're getting there. We got got spirit blessings, we've got we don't have the Rutal blessing going. We do have Sure Shot, which is good. I think it may be wise for us to get that Rutal blessing on a permanent basis. So I think now's a good time to build that shrine. And there we go. It defaulted to the Rutal blessing. But now it is storm season. Probably a good idea to send out an exploration mission to find that regalia, but we don't have any points in exploration magic, so I think we'll hold off on that for now. We've got a good relations omen, and we haven't really capitalized on it, so let's do that. Let's send an emissary out to the Flint Hearts this time, and yeah, we'll send them out with just 7 goods, and I think that'll be plenty. Yeah, we'll go with that. Oh dear. This isn't looking good. Devil cultists. Their very bodies warped and reconfigured by their unholy worship appear at your gate. As you reach for your weapons, they shout to inform you that of an imminent raid from the forces of chaos. For just 20 cows, we can teach you a simple and undemanding prayer to Wakboth, which will divert his formidable forces to another target. Do we agree? Do we sacrifice to Wakboth without their aid? Do we scornfully refuse, or do we attack them? Hmm. Wackboth is the destruction principle clad in otherworldly flesh. Fighters injured driving off these freaks won't be able to defend us in the bigger battle to come. I see no reason to doubt it will. If we must sacrifice to Wackboth, let us not also give cows to these fiends. We've never propitiated a chaos god. None can say that the glorious herds appease chaos. Hey, Hogan! How's it going? Good to see you. Actually, I'm going to give you a shout-out right now. Hogan! There we go. Good to see you. If you don't already follow Hogan, I really do suggest you give it a go. Hogan's an excellent streamer. Very entertaining to watch. And, yes, as I say, go watch him. Well worth it. You'll thank me later. And not a problem, Hogan. As I say, always worth shouting you out, I think. Anyway, back to the matter at hand. You mostly say bad words and play old games. Oh, you say funny words. I wouldn't say they're bad words. But you certainly do play old games, and that I definitely appreciate, especially as you play the sort of old games that I never had the opportunity to play myself back in the day. Anyway, yeah, I don't see us siding with chaos at all. Now it's a matter of principles. Do we attack these guys right now? Or do we just refuse them and hunker down for a fight? I think it might be best. Oh, we've only got 8 swords to our name right now, so I think we just refuse them. As they left, they called out, "Wackboth shall feast on your livers," and waved as if saying words of cheery farewell. People took heart in our refusal to be cowed. We dared to flout chaos to its face. We doubled patrol so we would not be caught snoozing when the Chaos Horde arrived. Speaking of whom, hello! A diverse horde of chaos creatures masses. Wow. Of course, it has to be ducks. Apparently drawn to Berenstead, the majority are brews, although there are also a fair number of scorpion folk and humans. We're on alert after the visit by Wackboth worshippers, so all 8 swords and 125 of the bows were available to fight them. It was difficult to count them, but Pelakara thought we were slightly outnumbered. Do we hunker down in Berenstead? Do we use spirits to fight them off? Do we rely on Elmul, the Defender? Do we rely on Humakt, God of Death? Do we rely on Asara, the Flame Sister? Our people most trust Dresta to lead the defense. Even though we spotted the raid, we didn't have time to gather everyone and their livestock into the fort. Sheltering in Berenstead risks the brews hunting them down. Beren used magic to destroy many chaos horrors at the Battle of Stormfall. Fighting chaos is not the same as facing human foes on the battlefield. It won't be easy, but I'm willing to take the lead. Okay, well, best magic user is a shaman, so spirits is the way to go with this at the moment, I think. So, yeah, I think we use spirits to fight them off this time. And I think we're going to have to use as much magic as we can spare, which is a whole 1 point. Dresta was the obvious pick to lead the defense. How much magic do you spend? All of it. How does Dresta focus her efforts? Most shamans can't control Oakfed. I may not be able to keep it from doing some harm to us. But you're a renowned magic user, so you are pretty good. You're not heroic with magic, but you're a lot... I would say you're well above most shamans there, Dresta. Beast spirits, I think, would be a safe bet. Oakfed is the... wild card. I know I said I was going to play this as if this wasn't a demo, but I want to give this a go. Let's summon Oakfed and see what happens. Drumming around a hastily lit bonfire, Dresta summoned a massive fire spirit. Like a fiery tornado, it swept lazily across our barns and houses before Dresta could force it to swing into the Chaos Force. Oakfed's roaring laughter almost drowned out the shrieks of the brews as they went up in flames along with the rest of the Chaos Army. There were huge scorch marks in our pastures, the sheepherders said. These would make grazing harder for a while. Dresta said that when you summoned Oakfed, you were playing with fire. Well, I think that was better than expected. We've now got pasture stress, which isn't so good, but could have been worse. And we've got damaged houses. Not so good. Clan mood is worried, but we're looking a little better off than we were before. But it is late storm season. We've got an expedition going out to the Flint Hearts. We're up in the north here, so... yeah. Seasonal market. That's going to be helping us. Can we actually afford more caravans setting up a trade route? Let's see if there's a clan around here that's got a good... the Zarhawks. Oh dear. Profaners of the dead. They hate us, but fear us. They also owe us a favour. Oh dear. The Zethmaring, known for eating rocks when hunger strikes. That doesn't sound too wise. The Tricorn Tribe, or clan. That might be worth investing in. Known for their wealth. Okay, Gustand. It's up to you. Good luck. Your emissary, Yathunda, nears the Flint Tart settlement. She's brought 7 cows in goods to offer as a gift. Let's just give the gift. They commended our gifts. I believe they're now more favourably disposed towards us now, though with riders it can be hard to tell. Understandable. The demo ends here. as notables gather to plan the future of the glorious Herd Clan. Thank you for playing. The full game will be available this summer. Well, there we go. The clan could be in a better mood. Our herds are adequate. Survival won't be easy, but we have a chance. At least nobody is starved. We will need to rely on our spirits much more than previous generations did. So there we go. There's going to be a lot of reading there. So, that was that. It's a bit of a crazy ending there with that chaos attack. But yeah, I really like how this is holding out. Our herds are adequate. Yes, exactly. Maxis. But yeah, my thoughts on this. I mean, if you've been around to see the Six Ages playthrough, you'd be really familiar with this. If you've been watching my King of Dragon Pass playthrough, you'd be kind of familiar with this. But Lights Going Out is actually bringing out some new challenges with the dead gods. We don't have access to some of the strongest gods in the game. I'll try to speedrun the demo for the prosperous ending. I don't know if there are different endings to the demo, but well, I'm quite happy with that. That was I think for a first look at this, I think we did fairly well. It's more like Chaos Ages. Yeah, it was kind of chaotic, wasn't it? It's chaos striking us pretty much every year in some form or another. But yeah, the fact that the game locks us out of some of the most powerful gods in the game certainly makes you have to think slightly differently from Rides with the Wind, Rides in the Wind, which... dear. Rides Like the Wind. There we go. So, yeah. Again, I mean, if you like Six Ages, I think this is definitely worth checking out for yourselves. And I'm going to be looking forward to this game coming out. But yes, I think that is it. I think I'm going to spend a day or so collecting my thoughts on the game. And then I'm going to start work on a first impressions video, which will be coming out on YouTube, probably after the bout of Six Ages 2 videos ends. But yeah, I think with that, we're going to call it a video. So for those of you on YouTube, take care and have fun.